Devon Woodland, president of National Farmers, was invited to address the Agriculture Committee of the Des Moines Chamber of Commerce. The first question put to Woodland was, what happens to PIC after the government's payment in kind program? You may notice our microphones picked up some faint background music. Sorry about that. Here's Woodland's reply to the PIC question.
What after PIC? After we come out, say they go too, then what happens after that program? Having met with those policymakers, they're not sure, but they are talking about a marketing order concept. This would mean you can plant all you want, but you'll only have a certificate to sell so much into the marketplace. Now, if you do this, in fact, what happens? You will reduce the number of farms, you will reduce the number of farmers, and as they talked about it, they said that isn't all bad. Well, we just happen to disagree. We think those who are not professional in the business have been gone a long time ago. And when you begin to cut as deep into the business as it's now cutting, there's something besides inefficient operators on those farms. And as you now, under that program, begin in to reduce the number of farm units, then your supply people will begin to feel the impact of fewer and fewer sales as well. So it's going to have a far-reaching effect, and we haven't felt it all yet.
Next was a question from Don Mum, farm editor of the Des Moines Register. He asked about what kind of volume of business does the NFO do?
We are an $800 million corporation. Our staff is, we believe, as highly technical as any staff in America. For example, our director of livestock, he run the Iowa beef, the Missouri beef, the Omaha stockyards, the Garden City, Kansas, the Colorado yards. He knows the business. Our director of operations worked for Beatrice for many, many years. The one that is now director of operation of our grain division run 400 elevators at one time, managed them under one of the major companies. We have technical ability in our legal field that draws from Bob Strauss's firm out of Washington. Our chief accountant comes out of New York, and these people all commute into our home office. We have there in the office 160 management and secretaries handling the business. And we are under contract with every major company in the United States, negotiating on a given day at least 100 contracts.
Highlights from NFO President Devon Woodland's speech to the Ag Committee of the Des Moines, Iowa Chamber of Commerce. Just after Ag Secretary Block expressed amazement at the huge size of the sign-up under PIC, there was a sort of a mini-news conference within the NFO. The Grain Department briefed Arlo Jacobson, editor of the NFO Reporter, and me for Here's Info, on the subject of what PIC will do. Dave Schwiers of the Grain Department and Dan Kudelink, who spent many years in the grain trade and is now a grain transactions consultant, were questioned by us. First, we asked Dave Schwiers if there's enough grain to accommodate those who signed up.
There is enough reserve nationwide to fill the PIC requirements. The problem will be is whether or not the grain in a particular area is there to fill the PIC requirement, the reserve grain. It's foreseeable that there are going to be three different situations where farmers receive grain from for their PIC bushels. One will be reserve that they own themselves. Another will be CCC-owned stocks. And a third possibility that the USDA has continued to talk about, and that is to require the producer to put his 1983 crop under loan and liquidate that loan and receive those bushels back in PIC bushels.
And a question by Arlo Jacobson, editor of the NFO Reporter.
Will this 1983 PIC program get this massive reserve of grain off our backs, or will another year of PIK be needed to restore some semblance of a supply and demand market?
The program initially, when it was announced as a two-year program. We are having, of course, large participation this year, which may make it so that the program is not used next year by a decision of the USDA.
Then we turned to Dan Kudelink, grain consultant. We asked him what he would advise grain growers to do when this PIC grain comes roaring onto the market.
And that question addresses what happens to the nearby supplies of grain when the grain that is allowable back to the producer under the PIC program is sold. My feelings are compatible with the organizations here in that they should be blocking an otherwise orderly and program marketing that grain into the marketplace as they get it back over the course of time that they're normally going to get it.
And a thought by Dave Schwerz.
Anything that the government can give to farmers in the way of price enhancement, they can also take away. Once again, tells us that if we want something that's long-lasting, that the price effects have got to come through collective bargaining efforts rather than through governmental action.
Agriculture Secretary John Block says the tremendous sign-up in PIC is about three times what he thought it would be. I'm here now with two fellows from the NFO Grain Department. They have a ringside seat at corn transactions and wheat transactions all across the United States. They're John Brundage and Mark Rolfing. And Arlo Jacobson is here, editor of the NFO Reporter.
Does the market really see PIK as a cutback?
John Brundage.
Well, as far as the corn and milo situation goes, come this fall, between what the USDA is projecting as far as production goes and what is going to be turned over as PIK payments, we'll have within 50 million bushels of what was marketable at harvest time last year, and we had a record corn crop as far as that goes. In regards to wheat this summer, between the USDA projected production, we'll have approximately 200 million more bushels available to be marketed than what we had in the summer of 1982.
What can we tell farmers to do to avoid a price disaster this fall?
Well, the farmers need to get the grain sold, take advantage of any ups in the market, get an average price established. If all this grain, approximately 2.8 billion bushels of corn and milo, goes into the market in the last 2 to 3 months of this year, we'll probably lose, price-wise, everything that was gained by the PIC program.
Orderly marketing, I've heard you call it sometimes.
Every time we have an up like we did on the 23rd after the PIC announcement, the bargainers were in there selling grain, taking advantage of it to get as high an average price as we possibly can for the farmer, to keep possibly from everything being sold at one time come October or November.
Mark Rolfing, you said you thought this would cause a kind of a fluctuating market?
Yes, I do, Phil. In general, this lack of consistency, I feel, will lead to a market that is very volatile. And when that happens, and if, in fact, the announcements that we've had the last few days allows this market to become bullish, we want to be in a position to take advantage of that and get a portion of the producer's grain locked in. We're recommending this. Get your grain sold. Not only spread out the sale of the grain, spread out the delivery of the grain. Don't let huge supplies of grain glut the market at any one time.
Mark Rolfing of NFO Grain. Roger Slotek, director of the Grain Department for National Farmers, says this: "We have customers who are eager to buy on forward contracts, and we must sign the bushels to stair-step the market upward and provide an orderly movement of grain into the market before the pick bushels are dumped at harvest time." When Andy Nutzling of the NFO Slaughter Cattle Division was conducting a seminar with his national staff people, we had a chance to interview him. We stopped Andy in the corridor and asked him this question. I was impressed at how much these people know about different kinds of contracts and different packers.
They sure do, Phil. We're doing business with approximately 35 to 40 packers on a daily business and numerous other ones on a weekly. We're getting here for 2 days going over which I consider probably a crucial time in forward contracting. The market is on an upswing, and that's when you want a contract. You don't want to be waiting for that thing to go south on you. And we feel that right now the time is to contract. We want to encourage our members or anyone else to, as far as that goes, to put in approximately 60% of their product. And a cattle feeder's a gambler. We all know that. So if he wants to gamble, let him go ahead and gamble on that 40%. And if the market goes higher, if the cash market is higher the time that he delivers, that's fine. That's what it's all about. That's where the money comes from. And if it happens to be lower, He still has 60% locked in at a profit, and he'll be in business next year.
The ones who consistently do make a profit, and the people who finance them and insist that they work with people who do make a profit, they're quite accustomed to this kind of a transaction, aren't they?
They sure are, Phil. Forward contracting isn't that new as far as paper. It's relatively new as far as actual delivery. And that's what we're all about. We don't deal in paper. We deal in the product. The individual actually delivers that product that he contracts. It has nothing to do with paper. And there's the difference. Margin calls, an individual gets in problems when he's hedging. He doesn't get in a problem with margin calls on our contracts. As a matter of fact, the packer gives him $1,000 down per contract. And if he contracts them at $69, that's his price that he gets, $69. The specs are very simple. It's basically a good load of choice cattle.
Andy Nutzling, director of the Slaughter Cattle Division. Andy told us that cattle producers from Minnesota, Iowa, South Dakota, Missouri, and Nebraska have told him that they have locked in a profit of $50 to $70 a head. Whenever the National Board of Directors of NFO meet, one of my interesting assignments is to interview the various members of the board. Today, let's hear Dayton Sharp from Colorado, Howard Fisher from Wisconsin, Art Wilson from California, and Rick Avila from Indiana. First, a conversation with Dayton Sharp, who talks about an unusual sort of ecumenical step among farm organizations.
We had a meeting in Akron the 7th of February, invited all the other organizations in, and they were amazed what we had to offer. It went over real good. We got more press coverage, TV, radio, newspaper than we'd ever got before.
Tell me about the other organizations being surprised at what the NFO has.
I think they're just beginning to realize that the National Farmers is a marketing and bargaining organization, and they're not set up to do this. I think they're beginning to realize it, and they realize the problem. We've got to get the cost plus a profit, or we're all going to go down.
Now, this is a conversation with Howard Fisher, a board member from the state of Wisconsin. When you get a new market for the milk produced by National Farmers, how do you go about saying to the new market, the new outlet, how do you convince them that we're the proper one to supply them?
Because we've got milk all year round. We will go to work and put them at 100% of capacity all year round. We've got very good quality. We've got the best reputation for quality in the state, and that's very important to us. And it's got to be a performance, too. We got to perform. Farmers, they've got to have somebody marketing for them. They're working too hard on a farm, 20 hours a day. They can't, haven't got time to market their own stuff.
Talking to Art Wilson, a member of the NFO National Board from California. When you talk to people out there in the Western agriculture, do they seem to understand better what National Farmers is?
Oh, yes. It's just a way of life, the collective bargaining is, and I think they understand it. The farmers do, I know now.
Art Wilson, board member from the state of California. And now here's Rick Avila from Indiana. How come the development in the New England states?
One of the reasons I think we've had the development is the activity and involvement of the membership. In other words, getting county committees organized, reorganized, opening those areas up, getting people involved in the movement. We've had about a 20% growth out there over the last 12, 14 months.
Rick Avila, NFO board member from Indiana. We heard several members today, Dayton Sharp of Colorado, Howard Fisher of Wisconsin, and Art Wilson of California. You have been listening to the County Informational Tape Service, compiled and edited by Don Mack, head of the NFO Broadcast Division. I'm Phil Allen, and that, for this month, is something to think about.